Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. This, as I said, is a continuation of our sermon series on the book on the life of David, a man after God's own heart. And part eight today is Winning the Hearts of the People, with the subtitle David Unites the Kingdom. Winning the Hearts of the People, David Unites the Kingdom. And I'd like to read for you that one verse that I showed to the kids, 2 Samuel 5, verse 3. So all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and King David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. Well, how do you know when it's the right time to fight for something that you believe in, and when it's the right time to compromise and back off and offer peace? How do you know? You know, that's a question we all have to answer at various times in our lives. And if we answer that question the wrong way, it can have some really devastating effects in our relationships, or maybe in an organization that we're involved in, like a church. You know, I over the years I've known many, many pastors, and because of a leadership role that I had, I was involved in a lot of situations where pastors were in conflict. And I knew one pastor many years ago who decided to fight when he should have compromised. He was a new pastor right out of seminary who was trying to establish his authority in his first congregation. And so when there were some things that he wanted to do that went against some long-standing traditions in the church, he just pushed as hard as he could, and he made demands, and he didn't back down. And he got into several heated arguments with people. And I got a call one day from our bishop, and he had been getting, the bishop had been getting calls from church members asking him to intervene, since I was the dean of our conference, an area of our synod that covered about 40 congregations. The bishop said to me, "Bill, would you go over there and talk to that pastor and see what's going on?" So I went over and I visited with that pastor, and I listened to his side of the story, and it became very clear to me that the things that he was fighting about were not things of ultimate importance. And he really should have been kind of backing down. He should have been looking for a way to compromise. But he was angry, and I could hear it in his voice when he talked to me. And I finally said to him, I said, "The people of your church are not the enemy. Satan is the enemy. He's the one that's winning the battle right now. You need to back down." But he didn't take my advice. He kept on fighting. Within a few months, the bishop was in his office and telling him he needed to move on to another congregation. You know, on the other side of the coin, I once knew a pastor who backed down when he should have fought. The issue was a youth mission trip. A large chunk of money had been left to the church that was specifically designated for the youth. And with the mission trip coming up, the church was going to use some of that money to subsidize the cost so that everyone could afford to go. But the problem is, some of the council members heard that several of the kids who were signed up to go on the trip were not actually technically members of the church. And, you know, the youth group had been growing, and the kids were inviting friends. Several of those friends were very involved in the group. Some of them even got their parents to come to the church. But the council made a decision that they would not use any of that special youth fund, and they had a lot in that fund. They would not use it to subsidize the cost of non-members. And the pastor of the church knew that that decision was wrong. He knew it would hurt the youth group of the church, and he pushed back a little, but when the council members dug their heels in, the pastor backed down, and it led to several young people dropping out of the youth group and several families leaving that church. So there was a situation when the pastor should have fought for what was right, and instead he backed down and was unwilling to stop that devastating decision that the council made. So when do you fight, and when do you back down? That was the dilemma that David was facing in our story for today. As I said, the title of this sermon is Winning the Hearts of the People, and that's what David has to do if he is going to become king of Israel, if he is going to step into the role that God has called him to, that the prophet Samuel anointed him for. The story begins in 2 Samuel chapter 2 with what I am going to call chaos in the kingdom. Chaos in the kingdom. The chaos was caused by the death of King Saul in a major battle with the Philistines, the battle that I talked about in the sermon last week. After David received word about the battle and received word about the death of King Saul, he was unsure about what he should do. And so the text tells us that David inquired of the Lord. Now, we don't know if he simply prayed about the situation or if he spoke to one of the prophets, but we do know that he received a word from the Lord saying that he should go to the town of Hebron. That was the prompting he got from the Lord. So David went to Hebron. Hebron was a town in the hill country of Judah, very high up, elevated, about 20 miles southwest of Jerusalem. So it's in the southern part of Israel. And David did not know what to expect. But David was up. We had an interruption in our power, and I don't know if that has turned something off. So anyway, David goes down to Hebron, this town in southern Israel, doesn't know what to expect when he gets there, but he was very pleasantly surprised by the reception that he received. The leading men came from all the towns of Judah, and they came there, and at Hebron, they anointed David as their king. And David was now 30 years old, and the promise of the Lord, the promise that he would be the next king, was finally beginning to come true. But the promise was not yet complete. David was now the king of Judah, but Judah was only the southern region of Israel. The Philistines were in control of the northern part of Israel, the very important Jezreel Valley that was won in that battle with Saul's army. And in the middle part of the country, that part was still controlled by what was left of Saul's army. And they were led by one of Saul's generals, a man by the name of Abner. So that was the chaos that existed. After the death of Saul, David knew that the right response at that time was to back down and wait for his opportunity. I mean, David was itching just to reunite all of Israel under his rule, and then he wanted to go after the Philistines and take back the Jezreel Valley. But David knew he was too weak right now to do that. And so for the next 5 years, David simply ruled over Judah in the south. He strengthened the defenses of their cities and their towns, and he built up his army into a strong fighting force. Then when David was 35 years old, he knew it was time to fight. Before, it was time to back down and wait. Now it was time to fight. And he knew that because Abner, the general in the north, made a bold move. You know, the U.S. Civil War began on April 12, 1861, when Confederate troops fired on Fort Sumter in the harbor of Charleston, South Carolina. And Lincoln did not want to be accused of starting a war. And so he waited for the Confederates to make a move. And firing on Fort Sumter, which was a Union-held fort, that was the move. And so with that, the war began. Well, the same thing happened with David. David was waiting for Abner, Saul's former general, who was ruling in the center of the country. He was waiting for him to make a move, and Abner did. When Saul and his sons had died in battle against the Philistines 5 years earlier, there was one son of Saul who had stayed behind in Gibeah, and that son's name was Ish-bosheth. Now, Ish-bosheth means man of shame, man of shame. It was probably not the name he was given at birth. It was probably a nickname that he had been given because he did not go into battle with his father. His father and all of his sons had died. And all of Ish-bosheth's brothers had died in the battle, but Ish-bosheth had stayed home and he had survived. So he was a man of shame. So Abner, what he did was he went and he put a crown on the head of Ish-bosheth and he said, "Here is the king of Israel. He is the heir of King Saul." But Abner was really the man who was running the show. But by making Ish-bosheth the king, he thought he could draw in all of those people who were loyal to King Saul. Abner then put his entire army together, and he marched right up to the border of Judah. Now, this was a very provocative act, and David had to challenge it. So David sent his army north up to that same border. The army of Judah was commanded by a man named Joab. Now, Joab, as we're going to see in later stories, had a brilliant military mind, and he was fiercely loyal to David, partly because he was David's cousin. Abner's army and Joab's army met at a small body of water known as the Pool of Gibeon. Joab was on the south side, Abner on the north side, and the two armies just stared across each other over that little pond for a few days. Both sides were ready for a battle, but they did not want to be the one who started it. Finally, it was Abner who sent some messengers over and suggested that their soldiers could have a little competition. He said, "I will send my 12 best men out. You send out your 12 best men. Well, let them have a little kind of mixed martial arts kind of competition." And Joab agreed to the plan. You see, both of them were hoping that the other side would take that little competition a little bit too far so that they could accuse the other side of starting the battle. Well, they didn't need to worry, because as soon as the men started fighting, the weapons came out. And when the weapons came out, those men, that 12 on 12, they began to kill each other. And both armies rushed in, accusing the other of starting the battle, and the civil war was on. That's how it started. Now, Joab's men won the battle that day. They ended up killing 360 of Abner's men and lost only 19 of their own. And Abner's army had to retreat. But a strange thing happened in the heat of the battle that day. And I have to mention it here because it will have an effect on what happens later in the story. During the battle, one of Joab's younger brothers, a man by the name of Asahel, spotted Abner on the battlefield. And so Asahel just took off after Abner. And Asahel decided, I'm going to be a hero. I'm going to go over, I'm going to kill Abner. It will demoralize his army. It might bring an end to the war right here, and I'm going to be a hero. So Asahel wanted to be a hero. But he overestimated his own abilities. When Abner saw Asahel making a beeline toward him, he knew exactly who he was. He knew that if he killed Joab's brother, this war could turn into a family feud. And so instead of standing and fighting him, Abner decided to turn and run back toward his own army. Well, this only encouraged Asahel. Asahel was young, he was strong, he was fast, and so he just kept coming. And Abner, as he was running, shouted over his shoulder, he said, "Stop chasing me, kid! I don't want to have to kill you!" But Asahel would not stop. And as he closed in for the kill, Abner suddenly turned around and put his spear through the stomach of Asahel. It wasn't really anything Abner could do. It was kill or be killed. But Joab would never forgive Abner for killing his brother. So the civil war began that day, and it would go on for 2 whole years. And during that time, it says, David's army grew stronger and stronger, and Abner's army grew weaker and weaker. If David had pushed that war to the end, he could have crushed Abner and his army. But the war would finally come to an end because of a stupid mistake by King Ishbosheth, the man of shame. Remember him? The cowardly son of Saul who was placed on the throne by Abner. Well, Ishbosheth was tired of being Abner's puppet king, and so he decided he was going to try to take out Abner. And he did it by making a false accusation against him. He accused Abner of sleeping with one of King Saul's concubines. A concubine is a slave wife. And if Abner had really done such a thing, that would be a highly symbolic act. It would mean that Abner was trying to take Saul's place, and it would be an act of treason. And I'm sure that when Ishbosheth made that accusation, he thought that all of the soldiers who had fought for his father, Saul, would rally to his side, would seize Abner and kill him. But it didn't work out that way. Abner forcefully denied the accusation, and then he said to Ishbosheth, he said, "You don't deserve to be king." He said, "I'm done with you." He said, "I'm going to go and offer my services to David." And to the horror of Ishbosheth, the leading men of Israel, the men who had been loyal to his father Saul, all agreed to join Abner. They all agreed to make peace with David and make him their king. And that really would be the end of Ishbosheth. Just a few weeks later, he would be assassinated by two of his own soldiers. Meanwhile, the story of Abner was about to take a shocking turn. Something was going to happen to Abner, and David's response to that event is what's going to reunify the nation of Israel under his leadership. This was how David won the hearts of the people. After Abner stormed out of the house of Ishbosheth, he took 20 men with him under a sign of truce, and he came down to Hebron and he met with David. And David threw a great feast for Abner and his men, and they sealed the deal that night. Abner and the army of northern Israel would pledge their allegiance to David, and together they would reunite under the kingdom, entire kingdom of Israel, north and south together, under the reign of King David. David was actually in the stronger position. He could have refused Abner, and he could have pressed on with the war, and he would have won. But David felt like the best way to unify the country was to create peace. And so that's what he did. And they feasted for the rest of that night, and in the morning, Abner headed north to bring the good news that David had agreed, and a treaty had been signed, and the civil war was over. But there was a little fly in the ointment. That fly's name was Joab, David's general. You know, I heard a story once about a World War II Navy ship that was sunk by a German U-boat in the South Pacific, and three sailors managed to grab onto a piece of debris and paddle their way to an uncharted island. One of the sailors was this Italian guy from New York named Tony. The second was a cowboy from Texas named Bubba. And the third one was a Norwegian guy from Minnesota named Ole. Well, they had been on that island for a few weeks, and one day they were walking along the beach, and Tony spotted something sticking out of the sand, and he dug it up, and it turned out to be a fancy bottle with a stopper. And so he pulled out the stopper, and to their surprise, out came a genie. And the genie said, "Thank you for freeing me from that bottle. As a reward, I will give each of you one wish. Take as much time as you want to think about it." And Tony said, "I don't need to think about it." He said, "I miss my city. I miss my neighborhood. I miss my family. I miss my grandma's Italian cooking." He said, "I wish I was back in New York." And poof, Tony was gone, back in New York. Well, Bubba didn't need to think about it either. He said, "I miss the open country. I miss the farm. I miss my family and the ranch." He said, "I wish I was back in Texas." And poof, Bubba was back in Texas. Well, the genie looked at Ole, and Ole said, "You know," he said, "Minnesota is actually kind of cold and snowy at this time of the year. And this island is really pretty nice." He said, "There's food here, there's water, I can do whatever I want, whenever I want to. The only problem is it's kind of lonely here. I really wish those other two guys were back here with me." Yeah. And poof. A great thing had happened to those three men. They were all going to be rescued from the island, and then Ole had to go and mess it all up. Well, that's exactly what Joab was going to do. Joab had been out patrolling with the army, and when he got back the next day, the whole town of Hebron was buzzing with the news. Abner had surrendered to David, and they had signed a peace treaty, and they were going to join the two kingdoms together. Israel would be united, and David would be the king. Isn't that great? But Joab didn't think it was so great. Remember in that first battle of the Civil War when Abner had killed Joab's little brother Asahel? Well, Joab remembered. And Joab had fought against Abner for 2 whole years, and he had seen his comrades die in the field. You know, Joab was the oldest son of his clan, and he felt it was his duty. He had to avenge the blood of his brother Asahel, and he had to avenge the blood of all those soldiers who had died because Abner had made war against David. So Joab sent some messengers to Abner, who was still on the road. He was heading back north with the news. And the messengers caught up with Abner, and they asked him to come back to Hebron. They said that David had a few more things he wanted to work out. So Abner told his men, "You keep going." He returned to Hebron by himself. But as he approached the gates of the city, Joab and another brother named Abishai were waiting for him. And they ambushed Abner, and they killed him to avenge the blood of their brother Asahel. Everything had been going so well. David was about to be crowned king of a unified Israel. God's promise to David was about to be fulfilled. And then Joab had to go and mess it all up. And everyone waited to see what David would do. The Southerners were waiting to see what David was going to do to Joab. The Southern people loved Joab. There were a lot of people who understood his grief over the loss of his brother, and also there were many Southern families who had lost husbands and fathers and brothers and sons in that two-year civil war, and it was Abner's army who had killed them. So there were a lot of people who were on Joab's side. The Northerners were also waiting to see what David would do. They wondered, had this all been just a trick to lure Abner down to Hebron so they could kill him? Were they now going to march their army north and try to crush the resistance? Was the civil war about to get more vicious and more bloody? So they were worried in the north. And David surprised them all. David chose the path of grace. He decided that there had been enough killing. The civil war had to come to an end, and the death of Abner would be the final casualty in that war. So David did two things. First of all, he declared a national day of mourning for Abner. The southern people would mourn the death of the man from the north who had fought against them. And David gave him a big state funeral. He had him buried there with honor in Hebron. And David himself put on a black robe and fasted for several days and wept publicly at the tomb of Abner. He was gracious with the northern people in the way he honored their leader. And David was also gracious with Joab. He did not put him to death, he could have. But instead, he ordered Joab and all of the men of the army to also put on black robes and mourn the death of Abner. And Joab did that. He honored the request of his king, and he did it. So in the north, the people were moved by the grief and the mourning of David. And all of the southern people were so happy that David had not put Joab to death. And so a new delegation came down then from the north, came to David at Hebron, and that verse that I read to you earlier says it all, 2 Samuel 5:3. So all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and King David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. All the pain and the suffering was put aside, and there was reconciliation. You know, several years ago, there were two young men who were both members of the church, one of my former churches. And one of those young men did something that caused the death of the other one. And it was very tragic. And my heart was breaking for both of those families. But the moment that is most powerfully burned into my memory was when the two mothers of those young men embraced each other at the visitation. I was there and I saw the one mother go up to the other and they embraced each other. And it was an act of pure grace by the mother who had lost her precious son. And I thought about that moment this week as I read about the gracious words and actions of David that united a country. People, I have said this before, and I know I will say it again. Anger and grudges and withholding forgiveness, those things destroy relationships. They destroy the hearts of the people who hold on to them as well. There is only one thing in this world that truly heals wounds and rebuilds relationships, and that one thing is grace. Grace is love. Grace is forgiveness. Grace is letting go of past hurts. And I pray that if I ever hurt any of you in some way, if I say something I shouldn't have said or do something that I shouldn't have done or the vice versa, I don't say something or don't do something I should have done, I pray that you will have grace with me. I pray that you will forgive me. And you know what? I promise I will do the same for you. I promise. Okay? That's what our God is all about. Our God is about grace, and that's what we need to be all about in the church. We need to be about grace in our relationships. Well, next week, David is going to experience the grace of God, but first he's going to have to learn a tough lesson. So I hope you'll join us here again next week as we walk through the next episode in the life of David, a man after God's own heart. Amen and amen.